Now, I want to, we don't have time to do any kind of full session, but I do want to give at least a minute to each one of our distinguished leaders up here, as well as say that they are not only leaders in their own part of the world, but they are also my close friends, and I appreciate them greatly. This was supposed to be a practical session showing how you can organize an event in your part of the world. Not everyone can organize a World Congress with thousands of people, but certainly you have the capability to organize an event with 50 people, with 100 people, with 500 people, and some of you already do. This will be an opportunity to hear how some of our distinguished guests and leaders here have done that. First of all, let me introduce them as a panel, because I'm going to ask a question, and then they're going to go down and actually answer the question. So we won't have any prepared speech, just a response to a question and answer. First, I look at the order there on the table. Teresa Okafor from Nigeria. Teresa has organized more than one event, multiple events, and I'll let her talk about this in a minute. We also have Alexei Komov. Alexei is our WCF representative in Russia and hosted the Moscow Demographic Summit last year. Our newest WCF regional coordinator and event holder is Rebecca. Rebecca's from Trinidad, and her event, which just was a few weeks ago, was an incredible success, and she already has plans for, I'll tell you what, I can't think of a better place to go to a regional event than the Caribbean, Barbados, St. Lucia. She's got all kinds of islands lined up, so encourage you to take advantage of these regional events. And certainly, last but not least, we have Pastor Ade Amuba, who is from the UK and our organization Christian Concern, which has also organized multiple regional World Congress of Families. So first, I'll let Teresa respond for 1 minute. Teresa, tell us about your organization and the events that you've hosted in Africa.
Okay, my organization is called the Foundation for African Cultural Heritage, and it's a civil society organization, but it's actually pro-life and pro-family in its orientation. And it's an umbrella organization comprising as many as 20 pro-life, pro-family organizations in different parts of Africa, Nigeria, Kenya, Ghana, South Africa, inclusive. And so we have organized two events in Nigeria. We've organized one in Abuja, the federal capital, in 2009, which was well attended. And we've also organized one recently, last year, in Lagos. And that was done in collaboration with the Nigerian Bar Association, which is the legal arm. And we had the support of the government as well, because it was well attended by officials of the Women Affairs Commission from the Federal Ministry of Women Affairs. So the government is in support of what we do. The public are in support of what we do, because through these events, they feel reinforced in their convictions. And a comment was made the first day when I arrived, which is, it's not just about what takes place, what happens during the World Congress for Families, it's what happens afterwards. During the World Congress for Families, obviously, there's a lot of honest discussions, you know, on faith and morals and the conformity between faith and reason, obviously, the dissonance between political correctness and truth, and honest discussions about things that affect us and affect the family. But then, most importantly, is the networking that happens, the benefits of those networkings, which actually tends to have far-reaching effect. I mean, just looking at Nigeria, for instance, after the World Congress for Family was organized, a number of those who attended from different parts of the world, we've established a very close relationship, and they have been very supportive, you know. Yes, the World Congress for Families, but also Family Watch International, Priests for Life, Human Life International, just to name a few, that have been really very supportive and have done so much that has affected not just the life of individual people in Africa, but even at governmental level, at the level of our Senate in Nigeria. Family laws are a given in Africa, because the culture is in support of the family. We have not just the natural family, but also the extended family. And so the families are still intact, but yes, there's also fear you know, fear and a lot of ignorance around. And so we have people outside the country who tend to play on these fears. And so what Congress for Family, actually, what it does is to create a lot of awareness about what is going on, and also putting it in a lighter note to show that the West is not just all about pop culture and, you know, same-sex union and what have you, but that there are people who also share our values, our fundamental values and thinking, way of thinking in Africa.
Thank you, Teresa. We're trying to make sure we get everyone a chance. Before I move to Alexi, I want to, Teresa did an excellent job of talking about the things that are going on, and the thing that, and she mentioned all the other groups. It's not just working with, I'm one person, actually our full-time staff at the Howard Center, World Congress of Families, full-time staff is only two people, and we have other part-time, but it is not about it's not about a huge organization coming in to do your event. What we do is just try to bless the stuff that's already happening. We can help with speakers, making sure that if you want to get an international speaker, we can help make the contacts. We have some experience in planning, budget. We can send Don Fenner, our communications director. And all of these things are to be tools that you can use. So you can come to us with an event that you're already planning and say, look, I want this to be a World Congress of Families, a regional event. And we'll work with you and actually can offer that designation. Alexi, tell us a little bit about your experience in Russia.
Yes, thank you, Larry. Can we have this presentation on screen? Right, very good. So as Larry has mentioned, we have organized last June the Moscow Demographic Summit, Family and the Future of Humankind, and it was a fantastic event. New York Times wrote three times about our event, and there was about 1,400 articles in internet and in newspapers, both in English and Russian. And we had all the distinguished guests there, and blessing of Russian Patriarch and Russian Parliament, American Congress, and we had ex-U.S. President candidate Alan Keyes and Hungarian Minister for Family and all the distinguished guests and demographers. And this experience was so successful that just last week I got a call from governor of a big region on Volga River, which is a Mississippi of Russia, if you will, Ulyanovsk, 1 million inhabitants, and they want to do the same type of event dedicated to demography in September 12th in Ulyanovsk for 1,200 people. And we're consulting them on the theme event, and we will invite some international speakers about this, and it will be a regional World Congress of Families event. And we have a full support of the governor, and they have the budget and all the state support that you need, because demography is such a big issue in Russia. And also we have in Nizhny Novgorod, another big city on Volga River with over 1.5 million people, end of November, the Sanctity of Motherhood program, which is run by Natalia Yakunina, who was one of the speakers here. And Larry Jacobs is invited there to speak from the international pro-life movement. And then we'll have a Rhodes Dialogue of Civilizations conference in October, also with a very strong pro-family international speakers presence. And then, very important thing is that we will have in 2014 the World Congress of Families in the Moscow Kremlin, inside the Kremlin walls in the historic place for 5,000 people. And we look forward to inviting all of you there. And if you can just quickly go through, here are the photos of the Moscow Demographic Summit. And what I just wanted to stress is that below you can see all the sponsors, and we were happy to attract like the leading corporations, Ural Sib and Rosinter, Interos, and metallurgic companies, like the top companies supporting our summit. And many of them have pro-family policies. For example, Ural Sib give discounts to the families with more children. The more children you have, the less you pay for loans. And that was a pretty interesting event. And we're working very actively in Russia. And there are five events that I've just mentioned. And the big World Congress of Families coming up in 2014 after Australia. And we will start organizing it right after Madrid. And thank you very much, and welcome to Russia in 2014.
Thank you, Alexi. Rebecca, as I turn the floor over to you, can you share with us as a first-time organizer of a regional event. As you describe it, mention how it started. How did you get started, and how did it come about as someone who was just making first-time contacts?
All right. Good afternoon, everyone. It's a pleasure to be here in Spain. I'm an attorney by profession. However, in 2009 or thereabouts, I began to do pro-life, pro-family work, and founded a nonprofit organization called the Elpes Center. The word Elpes is Greek for hope, and it's the kind of hope that's an expected hope. It has a definite end to it, which is a good end. In 2009, while researching pro-life, pro-family issues, I stumbled upon the World Congress of Families, divinely, I'd have to say. And so I packed my bags without knowing anyone and traveled all the way to Amsterdam. I believe I was the only Caribbean participant at that time. And immediately after the Congress, I began to, the wheels began to turn in my head about how can I bring some of this truth back to the Caribbean region. Because unlike Teresa, where she still has strong government and grassroots support for the family, or in Alexi's case, where things have slid so far down the slope that the government is now supporting him in bringing the demography back, in the Caribbean, we're a bit like a frog on boil. And the people in the region, their values are slipping, the values regarding the sanctity of human life, regarding traditional marriage, regarding even an appreciation for the freedom of faith that they have. And we are under tremendous external pressure from international governments and other organizations, including the United Nations, to change the moral code of our country and to change the moral code of our region. So in January this year, I began to just pull together some of the contacts that I had made, not outside of this Congress as well, but others that we've worked with over the past 3 years. And I quickly shot an email to Larry and said, "Hey, Larry, I'm putting together a pro-life symposium, a little seminar in Trinidad." And his immediate response within 10 minutes or so was, "Hey, let's turn this into a regional World Congress, a family event." And the rest is history. So within 4 months, the end of April, we had the very first Caribbean event that focused on the life, on sanctity of human life, on the family, and on freedom. It was attended by 175 people. We may have had the smallest budget of any World Congress event. It cost us about 16,000 US. Most of that came from registration fees. I knocked on doors for sponsorships, but we didn't get the sponsorships. We didn't get support from conventional places. Not even the government wanted to support what we were doing because, of course, it was running counter to where they're at right now. The support, however, came from the grassroots, from individuals, from religious leaders. And what has happened following that Congress is that people are now saying to me, "Hey, Rebecca, we never heard these things before. You've really awakened us to some of these issues. What do we do now?" So when I go back home, there are efforts that would be rolled out to do another regional event. But even beside the regional event, we want to do some family-focused groups within Trinidad and among other leaders to build the movement. I just want to say this for those who are here. There is such an apathy towards the sanctity of human life, towards traditional marriage, towards family life, towards our faith. And it is essential that we build a movement going in the other direction. We need to move from being on the defensive, where we're being shrunk back against the wall, to being on the offensive. I say this to my people in Trinidad when I'm sharing the vision, and I'll say this to you if it means anything, that this fight is not theirs to win. It is ours to lose. And so we need to put all our muscle, all our strength, all our passion, all that we have behind it, because ultimately, if we allow the moral slide to continue, the collateral damage will be done to our children.
Thank you, Rebecca. Pastor Ada Amoba, I specifically want you to mention the difficulty you had in even finding a place to hold this most latest regional Congress, but please, you have the floor for 2 minutes.
Well, I always like challenges, because challenges for me become channels of progression. You turn it around the positive way. And we've had two events in the United Kingdom, one last year and one this year. We try to make sure the events are timely, relevant, and practical. And like Teresa said, beyond the day of the event, the impact must be lasting. And what I see happening is typical of what some governments do in the United Kingdom is they complicate to implicate. They take something so simple, you know, complicate it and get people implicated by it. And marriage and family is at the heart of that in the United Kingdom. When we had the first regional event in June of last year, we just had a coalition government who was a year into government and wanted to raise the issue about family. I think we were quite a bit prophetic when I come to what happened this year. And we titled it The Future of the Family in Coalition Britain and Constructing a Compelling Case for the Family. One of the things we tried to do is to get, you know, influencers within the community, parliamentarians, church leaders, stakeholders, different people into those meetings and hold it in a public square that is prominent and relevant to the community, and also align it with the relevant issue of the day. That event went very, very well at what was at the venue called the Law Society. However, a year on, the issue in our country, which is this year, was marriage. Based on the fact that the current coalition government, our prime minister, came out publicly to say he was going to basically redefine marriage. And when he said that, he drew the battle line, because we were not going to take that line down easy. We're currently in consultation in the United Kingdom. The government is doing that. So we timed this year's regional event around this time in May. And Don Feather was there just last week when we had it. And we titled that one, One Man, One Woman, Making a Case for Marriage for the Good of Society. Well attended. At the same time, the impact is beyond the day. It's amazing that we used the Law Society, a very good place to have it last year. But this year, they turned us down. They turned us down and said the only reason we cannot have the event in the Law Society is based on their diversity and equality policy. Men, the battle is on. The game is on. They have not even redefined marriage in the United Kingdom, and we have an organization like the Law Society already chucking us out based on that line of thought. Well, if it's diversity and equality, what I'm asking is, so is Christianity not part of that diversity? And is the Christianity not part of that equality? I want to reemphasize what my colleagues have said. We have to work on this together across the nation. It's a global fight, and it's a battleship. We need all hands on deck. We need to learn from each other, from country to country, how best we strengthen what we do in the regions. And we must also remember that there is a voice out there that has a different opinion that we have to meet. When we have these conferences, let it not just be preaching to the converted. We have to reach out to those who have a different opinion and find ways to draw them in. And it was good this year to bring in people like Philip Blunt in, who sympathizes, but we're bringing him in now helps him to connect with the issues. People must connect with the issues, not just sympathize with it. Thank you.
Thank you, Pastor. I don't think you know how much it pains me not to offer each one of these. Each one of them could honestly give you an incredible, 1 hour presentation each. And Teresa, Alexi, Rebecca, and Ada, they are resources that you need to talk to. You need, I'm encouraging you. This might be the mountaintop experience, and you'll go home and you'll say, okay, now what do I do? Well, you need to meet these people over to the side after the session. and they will tell you what you can do in your region. They'll tell you that you only need one person to start this. They each came as individuals and then got their groups and their partners and friends and family, and they sacrificed long hours and they organized events where no one else had before. So please join me in giving them another round of applause.